Today I got a 2006 Harley-Davidson 6.0 truck here. It needs an oil cooler, an EGR cooler. I like to use the Bulletproof EGR cooler because it's proven it's pretty good, along with the Ford factory oil cooler. People, I know I've made a couple of videos on this showing different little things, and I get still getting questions asking about different connections or bolt torque or procedures or sequences. So I'm going to go ahead and do a video here, and I know it's going to be a little bit long because I'm going to actually show each and every item on it, so that way if it's your first time, you should be able to follow this video and do it. I'll edit it down as much as I can and show the highlights of things that are important, but hopefully I show every step and it makes it so you're able to do this. Okay, remove the coolant bottle. I'm going to take the degas bottle off of here. Be careful not to break the nipple here, but if you do, I have a video showing how to fix this. We're going to move the coolant bottle. Now in the air filter, I just leave the filter minder in back there. Disconnect the mass airflow sensor if you have it. Now a lot of times that won't come out that easy. If not, I'll reach underneath here and push the snorkel out. If you leave your bolts up here, be careful nothing falls down inside the exposed engine. Now with the air filter off, we'll go ahead and spray some lube on the other side. Take this off. One of the best things I can suggest, this is a snap-on, but the Harbor Freight ones work just as well. Okay, once it's locked in here into the engine lifting eye, we'll pull it back here, pop it off. Then down here, we'll pry it. If you're doing this in the colder months, you may have to take a blow dryer and heat these up a little bit or let them sit in the sun. Remove the air intake hose. I lift it out right here. Just pop this out. Also, on the previous video, I show how to get these O-rings. I'm going to take the oil filter cap off. These are those aftermarket oil filters. So when you take it off, make sure that it has the right oil filter in relationship to the size of the cap. We're going to do that. I'm going to use the Matco. It's diesel fuel filter 36 millimeter or DFF 36. Because what's nice about this, it's a 36 millimeter for these caps, but it's also with these notches, it's made for the 7.3 fuel filter cap. So it's pretty handy to have. Now when you do this, if it has the right oil filter in it, you're going to see it full. This one, as you can see, it's empty. So when they're empty, that's usually an indication that it has the wrong filter in there and that it wasn't done properly. But see, there's not really any oil draining. So this setup right here was wrong. You can also see the size of the cap versus where the oil filter is put down. So this oil filter wasn't doing anything. You always got to watch for having these large caps with a small or a factory size oil filter. I like to remove this wire loom here just to get things out of the way so I can see a lot better. You got to be careful, especially as these trucks are getting older. This gets pretty brittle and they crack. If you start to hear them crack, then just cut them off with a set of dykes. That way you don't damage the vehicle, but you'll probably find most of them already broke. Gotta pull it out, bungee it up out of the way. Go from the inside here, that way it helps to pull it back. Just use a 10 step wrench, remove the turbo supply line, This is the oil supply to the turbo. This is the newer design without the flexible hose in there. The hose has a tendency to swell or crack and reduce oil flow. So this is the new style, which actually has improved flow to the turbo. Not completely necessary, but if you want to do all the upgrades and get one. That method even works with the flexible one. Disconnect the actuator. There's two types. There's the old early type that'll have a metal band that you release. This one right here, you just want to be really careful. Do as minimal prying as possible, as long as nobody's broke it already, to remove it without breaking the clips. Get them off without breaking it. Release that. Now what I did to release that, I just push it in and move it out of the way. And that way I got the wire loom out of there. Again, back with the 7/16 or 11 millimeter deep, we're gonna take the band clamp off of the exhaust downpipe. That one, you can either take the nut all the way off and not lose it, but I like to just open it up. And because it had the WD-40, the penetrant on there, you heard it just pop. Now you take the clamp and take it all the way out of there. Just take the whole clamp off, move it aside. Now the top one, luckily somebody's worked on this one before, so it's in a decent position. I can get right to it. If not, what I normally end up doing is taking a small wrench, like an 11 millimeter or 7/16, and having to loosen it up with a small wrench. But again, because this one's in a position, already been removed, we can get it off a whole lot easier. And again, a couple of things. If you loosen it up enough, you can see that way it's cut out. So if it's loose, I can push back on the top and remove it out of there. So that's what my goal is, to do that. If somebody's over-tightened it and ruined this and it's stuck, you will have to take the nut all the way off and pull it out. But ideally, you want to try to just do that and release it. So I've got this one loose. I've got it unhooked, but it's still stuck. So what I like to do is just tap on it. If you have to, put some more penetrant on it, but also you can try. Just usually the vibration makes it come loose. Okay, that one's stuck, so we're going to spray it a little more with penetrant and let it sit for a second. There we go. You can hear it. It sounds different. So I'll take it, spread it, and actually put it on the turbo. Now, as you can see, the clamp is off of there. Yeah, I'm gonna take the ficum off first before I take the turbo off. And we switch sides on you just because I wanna show removing the clips. And again, this is the late 05 and up style, the 05, 6 and 7. So it's a little bit different. If not, you have different sizes. But basically it's the same procedure. So let's take the ficum off. Now the trick with the ficum is, you want to lift up here, you want to make sure these connectors are pushed all the way up in there. So then we're going to squeeze both sides, and if we have to, we'll rock it to get it out. You start with the front one, set it on top like that, like what I just brought it out, then go to the next one. And if it fights you, you need to take this and push it up into it harder. So we're going to do that one, same thing, bring it up here, and reach for the back one, and bring it out. Again, rocking the ficum if you have to, and pulling it out. But the best thing I tell you is, if they stick on you, they don't want to come out, push this up into the ficum harder, and then rock it like this, and then pull it out. Okay, this is, again, this is the 05 and 6 up, so we have the exhaust back pressure, the EBP up here. We're going to disconnect this wire, take it out of the way. And one of the things I want to discuss while we're doing this, when you remove these, make sure you have the insulation and this clip.
without this clip. They're either white or blue. Some of the early ones are blue. But if you don't have this clip on here, they have a tendency to wiggle all the time, and your connection gets poor, and you'll start having surging spikes either on this or the ICP sensor, the injection control pressure sensor on the other side, which I'll show here in a few minutes. But you want to make sure that this clip is on here. Now, if this is lost and you're in a bind, what you can do from Diesel Truck Parts Direct, he sells a complete pigtail here. He sells a lot of pigtails, but he has the old style. This is like the 03 and earlier, and especially on the 7.3 that doesn't use this retaining plastic clip here, and it's a whole lot better. So if you need it, get these from him. He's on eBay and whatever else. They're pretty cheap, and it's a nice substitute for doing this. Just make sure you do it properly with the proper crimps and don't get your wires messed up. Okay, we're going to disconnect the glow plug harness connector. This is for your glow plugs. When it's like this, it's latched down. When you see this out here, it's latched down. You can try to just push it backwards like this. If it's not too cold or it's not messed up, you can do that and disconnect it. Otherwise, you have to use some pliers and get it back. But once that is unlatched, just squeeze it and pull it out. I'm going to move this back out of the way. So that one's out of the way. Now we'll start on the turbo. Okay, to remove the turbo, no fancy tools here. That, again, even though it's a snap-on pry bar, you can use a Harbor Freight one. That is a Pittsburgh Harbor Freight extension. Just get 18, 20, 24-inch extension. They're cheap in a set. It makes it real handy to get to the back bolts. That's a 6-inch extension, just a gear wrench, and a Duralast ratchet to get the bolts out. So that's the tools I'm using to remove the turbo. Got the 10 swivel there with the long extension. Take the bolts out here. You got the 3 mounting bolts on the turbo. If you have the 03 style and you're doing this, it's a little bit more difficult because of one of the bolts in the back. And also on the 03 style, you want to remove the shield up here just for clearance. On the 04 and up, you don't have a problem with that. But we'll take the 3 bolts out that mount the turbo on. And on the back, that's why I have the 6-inch with a shallow 10mm. We'll go back here again. This has to be the 04 and up because it's stripping down. The 03 goes from the side. So we'll take this, reach back here and put it on the turbo bolt. Take the ratchet, stick it through right here. Out with the bolt. Okay, now hopefully you have the stock exhaust because it makes it a whole lot easier if you have the aftermarket exhaust. It doesn't have this clip here that helps hold it in place. But anyhow, with this one being the stock exhaust, I'm going to take it, lift it up, and move it out of the way. If you bend this, it's no big deal. Just bend it back. So with that out of the way, I have all the bolts out. Now I'm going to take my pry bar. I'm going to just go underneath the turbo here. And I'm going to take it, lift it up, and move it out. Now, one of the things I want to stress, I never loosen up the up pipe. It's never loosened, and I just pop the turbo off. Now, I just grab it. Everything's on. Remember, the battery's disconnected, so I don't hurt the alternator or the wire, because right now it would be when it would arc. I take the turbo, I rotate it like this, and I bring it up through here. And, of course, insulation, which I'll show, is just the opposite. So we have it out. And we got it out of here. Now, I know every time I make videos, people always tell me what I should watch out for. So what I'm trying to think of is on this one, be careful of your oil standpipe. If you're not sure and you think you might break it, if you have the stock filter cap, put it back on. If you have those aftermarket tall ones, it makes it harder for the turbo to come off. But either you gotta have to be careful or put your cap back on. And again, make sure your batteries are disconnected so you don't arc the alternator, because some of them are clocked up here at 12 o'clock. Okay, now this belt, some of them are pretty tough, So what I'm going to do is I'm going to grab it, and I'm going to push the tang up, which I'll show the tang in a second that retains it. But see, as you can see, the belt's gone there. Now, if you can, you can pull it up with one hand and do it. I know that's pretty hard. I'll show this, but this can be dangerous, so you got to be really careful. If you take your pry bar and you push against it, you can pry up on it. But again, the preferred method would be is to grab it, either with one hand and do it, or take it and have somebody, while you pull it, push the tang up. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to grab this here, pull on it, and then clench it. Now that with the belt caught, I can take it and remove it. Remove the belt, and my belt tensioner is latched in place.
Okay, we're going to remove the alternator. I like to crack the bolts loose first with a regular hand tool so I don't damage my ratchet. Again, battery's disconnected, so I don't have to worry about arcing any of this. Make sure you don't drop any of the bolts. We're going to be removing the intake. Now here, this has a clip that we push down on. We're going to push in on that and pull it out. Alternator's off. Be careful, don't put anything on your batteries. And again, the glow plug thing, the same on this side. We'll just take it, push it in, and once that's released, now we can unplug it and take that one off. I'm going to take this right here. I see a lot of times people have it back here. That's not where that goes, but I see a lot of it like that. This is for the cars that this is a heated control valve to shut off the air conditioning, or to shut off the water flowing through the heater box to help the air conditioning be more efficient. It goes on the front, so it's there. If you don't have this option, like some of the work trucks don't have it, you'll see it up here on the heater box like this. But we'll go ahead and take your heater hose off of here. What I should have recommended too, while we have the 10 out, taking the alternator wire off, take off your MAP sensor, manifold absolute pressure sensor, also known as the boost sensor, the turbo pressure sensor on these. So I'm gonna take this off. Now there's a clamp on down here. Two things, I guess. I don't normally take the clamp off. It's up to you if you want to. But one thing I strongly suggest is when you have this off, look for cracks, because this is common that they crack on here. So if you're not sure, you can replace this. You can use a quarter inch fuel line, but the quarter inch fuel line gets hard and brittle and break after a couple years. I've seen people use vacuum lines, and I also see them in here without any clamps on them, and they still hold. So it's up to you. I'm just trying to give you guys suggestions as you run into different things as you're doing your job. And I just leave that on over there without a problem. If you usually I have more damage trying to pull that hose off and breaking it, so you can. If you do decide you want to remove it, this is normally up here. We pull it down, we push in on it. You have to pull the red down, expose that, and pull it out. You can move this out of the way. I normally don't, but we'll show it both ways. And this was fixed before. That's a splice. You won't find that in yours, probably. Pull the clamp off. Heater hose. Now when I'm doing this, I'm using light pressure. If you use the pliers to release that, don't sit there and gouge this and damage your hose, otherwise you have to replace it. But I take the hose, pull it off. I usually just get it up here. This one right here was leaking. You can see signs that it's leaking there and on the engine. So if you have a heated control valve, make sure you replace it. If you go look it up for an 05 and up, they'll tell you it's not available. You have to buy it as a whole hose assembly for 70 to 100 bucks. If you tell them it's for an 03, they'll look it up, they'll give you the heated control valve, and it's the exact same thing. Just tell them you got an 03 style truck, so it works. Then we're going to disconnect the wires here and start to get them out of the way. Same thing, this is the other one I was talking about. Make sure it has this on here.
If not, get your clip and replace the pigtail, because especially with the ICP up here, this will really surge. If you got a truck that's surging, you're seeing that idle, all of a sudden, wah, it'll go up. It's probably that connector missing. So make sure that you have the retaining plastic piece on there. Make sure that this is on there. You do not want it to look like that. You want this piece on there. So make sure that's there or replace it. Now here, I just take it, push it on the clips, and push them, take them out. Same way down here. Take both of them out. Okay, now before I start to do the wire loom and everything else, because what I do is I like to pull the wire loom off and stick it back here. Actually, what I normally do is take the fan off, and I have the fan and the shroud, everything out of the way, but that involves special tools. I'm trying to do this so the average home guy can do it. So I'm going to leave the fan on here, which I normally don't do. But to get the fan shroud out and get my wire loom and get everything over here, I'm going to take the shroud, there's two pieces. You have the part that's against the engine, you have the outer one. So I'm going to go ahead and take this off. And to take this shroud out, I need to move the radiator forward. So we already have it drained. This is 7mm. Now when you're going back together with these, you want to make sure you notice the orientation that it was. Put it back on the exact same place, because if you do it in different spots, the way the hose has indentation, it'll leak on you. So make sure when you're going back together that you put it back in the same spot. You can see where it goes. Let's go ahead and do that and just get the bracket off. Here we have those brackets off. Now what we have to do is take this positive battery cable and move it back so we can get the radiator back enough. So we'll take it, expose here. Just using a regular door panel tool, get these out. You find most of these already all damaged. They just happen that way over the years. Take this, just push it back. I just move this temporarily right there. Hose off. And take it and push it back. Lift it up, and again, I'm not using a lot of effort. I'm going to show that, so we'll take this out and we'll lift it out. Be careful of your fan wires. Let's take it out of here. Once I have the shroud out, I like to take it. I'll put the positive wire just kind of back laying in there for right now. I'll put the brackets back on with one of the bolts, that way the radiator has strength, because I'm going to be leaning on it quite a bit. Bolts on it for a second. Okay, we're going to loosen the four bolts up that retain, well, four on an 04 and up, five if you have an 03, it has an extra bolt here, but we're going to loosen the four bolts that retains the shroud to the front cover here. Now what I want to do too is take, release the fan here, so we just push in on it right there, pull it back, so that's released. 6-inch extension, 15mm socket. I'll loosen them up by hand at first. Now I'm using a 3/8 drive one. Now the top ones are loose, they're back a little bit. And if you have to, or I'm gonna loosen the bottom ones up just so I can get it further forward to work on it. Okay, now doing the bottom ones, if you don't want to break your shroud, you want to use a backup wrench. Again, they're 15, so I've got it. I just take a 7/8 wrench, which is the same as a 22mm for you younger guys. But I'll take it, now I'll hold it, and I'll break it loose. And I'll take these bottom two bolts out.
Okay, now we have the bolts out of the shroud, so we can lift it up. Hopefully this is not broke. And even though this has a stud and threads on it, there's not supposed to be a nut on there. There's actually a gap on it. There's a gap when it's all the way tight. So this does not take a nut or anything like that. We'll take it, move it up a little bit. That helps to give us, because we're gonna be taking the bolt out of the fuel line here in a minute. It also gives us more room to pull the intake off in a second. So I'm going to take off the turbo mounting bracket, and just like anything else, we're going to spray the bottom of the pickup tube just to ease the O-ring coming out. Sometimes you can wiggle it and it come out like that. Other times I have to get in there and pry it out. So luckily that one came out easily. Take the four bolts off for this.
Now with the four bolts out, I'll go ahead and just lift this out around the EGR cooler and take it out and make sure we have all the bolts out of there. A lot of times too, you find that the turbo bolt wasn't in the front. That's common. We'll look for it and get it now. We're gonna make sure that there's no other stuff on here. Look, I'm finding an extra nut on there. There's another washer down there. Because if you get any contamination in here, that's when you start to have failures. So I found a washer too. So we get that out. So now that we have those out of the way, one of the things too, what I'll do now, is I'll take it, clean off my O-ring, and I put this back. The reason why I put that back inside the cover, this is your turbo drain back oil tube, is I don't want to get any oil into the system. The reason why I try to keep it clean, you can see the screen on your IPR valve, and here's a penny, so you can see the size of it. I mean, a penny completely covers it. Literally, you get yourself 100 grains of sand or so, almost nothing contaminating the system, you're going to have a stalling issue. I see them anywhere from, my worst is I've gotten one before that's taken 7 new IPR screens just to get it to run, to where guys maybe go 200 miles to 2,000 miles and it stalls on them, or they lack power, and it's because the dirt slowly accumulated here on your screen until it plugged it up. Cannot stress enough, when you're doing the oil cooler or you have these engines open, keep it clean, or otherwise you're going to be doing your IPR valve, your IPR screen multiple times. Okay, I'm going to focus on the wire loom here. One of the things I want to show, I'm going to do the injector wire loom first. It's separate. I'm going to pull the clips out. Now, guys tell me not to do it this way. It's up to you, if you, however you want to. I guess the proper way, you would push it down, push the clip down, and pull it out. That's how to do it. You can do that. Again, just push it down, pull it out. But some of these, as they start to get harder to do, what I like to do is just take it, and I twist it and I pull it up. And then you want to make sure that you keep the clip and you keep where it's at. The reason being is because if you lose the clip, it's not magnetic, or it's very little magnetic, magnetized here, it's non-ferrous. So you can lose it and you can't get it out with the magnet sometimes. So you got to be really careful. What I do then, if I do it this way, I'll pull it out and I'll take it and I'll put it right back on instantly so I don't lose it. Just put that in the grooves and set it down, and it ends up like this. So whichever way you prefer, I actually like that way better. And we'll go ahead and, especially on the ones that's hard to get to, like these areas. And just pull it out, just be careful. Wanna make sure you have your hand on it. Okay, we're gonna remove the wire loom both sides. Now if you notice how this is weaved, they have, for the IPR socket, normally goes through the wire loom for the injectors. So it's usually this back one's up. Sometimes I see it with both of them. But for the IPR, for the injection pressure regulator that's part of the main loom, it's weaved through here. It's not real critical important, but that's how it comes. And also, some of these have studs in different places. So I don't cover that too much, because an 03 is different than an 04 versus 05 and up. But I'll get the loom out, the wire loom out, the injector wire loom, and pull it out here. Okay, once I have the loom out separate, some guys will leave them together, that's up to you. I like to pull them out separate, but then I'll go ahead and put all my clips back in. That way I don't lose them and have to worry about them. the flat spot. You see here one area that has actually a flat spot that's raised, or the top part. That's the way the clip goes down, and it goes down there like this. And if you don't like that way of how I pry them out, then just push them down and do it. Because sometimes I'll have injectors that are broke that way.
Now we're going to remove the rest of the wire loom and bring it forward. What I do, you can take this bracket and leave it on, or you can just disconnect it. And not all of them, again, have this bracket. That's an 05 and up. You just unclip your IPR back there. You have this dial, you just take the tape, push it back, expose it. And usually what I do here is I'll bend it back, and I'll just stick it like this. That way when I go back on, I can push this up, latch it, and I can just undo this and bring it back around. So I just do that just to keep it out of my way. Just do that. And this is the other style. Like sometimes your turbo actuator has these type. The early ones had this type. It's the same connector, same fitting. It's also the same on the 7.3 injector if you need an extra end. Or you can get it from that diesel truck parts guy direct. He has all these different wire looms. Now we'll take off the intake air temperature sensor here. You want to be careful with these. As they get old, they get brittle. So try to go as little as possible, just not to break them. And we'll lift them all out. Same with the EGR. Up here again, just be as careful as possible. They do like to break. And diesel truck parts Direx has those fittings too. Or the wire pigtails, the wire end. Most of them go underneath your fuel line. So your fan, this is your water temperature sensor. They go underneath there, so just feed them back out that way. Underneath the fuel line, this is your fuel line here for your passenger side cylinder head. We'll get the oil pressure switch off. The single wire is the oil pressure switch. The dual wire is the oil temp sensor. So we'll get them loose. Now they're all off. And also, if you notice, especially when you're going back together, your glow plug wire is underneath your main wire loom. So when you go back together, you want to put it that way. So now I'll take it here, get it rest away out of the way. Bring this around your AC line, bring that out. Put this around your heater hose. We do have to get off all the studs. Bring that around the heater hose tube. Bring your whole wire loom out. Normally, see, I don't have the fan on, and I stick it right down here, and it's no problem. We're going to bring it out. We're going to leave it like this. Now our wire loom is out of the way. This shouldn't be a problem, so we'll go ahead and get the fuel filter off. Okay, at this point in time, this is really critical and crucial if you don't want a catastrophic engine failure. You want to make sure there's nothing on either side, whether it be the injector clips, or a bolt, the nuts that fallen off, guys dropped them and left them down there, or different studs. Check it. Look down inside there, take a few minutes to look at it, drag a magnet, do whatever it takes, and blow it off. So let's get... Make sure that's all clean. And another reason why we're doing that, when I start to remove the fuel lines here, they're going to leak. If you want to open your fuel filter, try to get it out, that's up to you, or get your bowl empty. I usually just let it go. It's not a big deal.
unless you've got a some kind of special driveway you don't want to get anything on, then be careful, because it does, you are going to lose a little bit of fuel when you open these lines up, especially here on the for the driver's side head and the return one. I'm going to take those off. You can try it and see if it comes loose without a backup wrench. That one did, so that's good. Or if you're not sure, just get the backup wrench first. What I mean by the backup wrench, I'll show you here in a second. Just take your 17 on there, take it, break it loose. You have the lines off for both cylinder heads. Now this one can get to be a bear sometimes. You can either use a 21 millimeter and a 22 millimeter on it, or I just take a 13 16ths and a 7/8. I'll take my 7/8 here against it. I'll take my 13 16ths here with it locked on there. And sometimes, again, you notice the hose is down, so it makes it a lot easier. And break it loose. Hit it with the pop and it comes loose. Of course, don't have your fingers or anything in it. Get that one loose. Now other guys, they'll put zip ties around here. If you don't want to lose this, just put a zip tie on it. If you have the smaller zip ties, they work pretty good. I don't like to cut them because then I have sharp edges. I keep catching myself on. That way you don't have to sit there and chase it. Same way here. This one, that way you don't have to go down there and chase it afterwards. So we just put a zip tie on it. Make it a lot easier. Okay, remove the back banjo bolt here. Now you got to be careful not to drop the ceiling washers. I reuse them all the time. I've done it for years. Never had an issue. I usually just take it, put my two washers on it. That way I keep it and set it aside to go back together. Take a Torx 45, get your four bolts on here. And when you're going back together, do not tighten these down, snug them all up evenly, and then draw it down with these ears. If you tighten one up too much, you break one of the ears off. Talking about these ears here, they're real vulnerable. If you go and tighten one down and torque it way down and you draw it down the other ones, these usually break off. So make sure you draw it all down nice and even and clamp it down. It doesn't have to be real tight and you won't have any issues. Okay, there's no special order like as I'm doing this. I'm just trying to do things as I notice and what tools I have out. But again, we're going to spray the clamp around the back of the EGR cooler. And also notice the up pipes are not loosened. I never loosen them. If you loosen them, you're going to have problems aligning it afterwards. So I never deal with, never take them off. Let's go ahead and get this bracket off. On the back clamp, just like always, I'm going to spray it with some penetrant to help to loosen it up. Same way, well this one's already all nice and loose because it was soaking from earlier. I just position it up front here. Now there is a bolt for that cover that makes it a little bit of a pain, but if you get it, you can maneuver it and put it there. And if you, I usually leave it there. If you don't like that, then just take it, spread it open, and you can feed it out of there and have it off. Same way too, when you go back on, you just take it in front of that bolt, feed it through, and walk it back and hook it back up. So it's up to you if you want to leave it on or off. Okay, we're going to take the bracket loose here on for the heater hose. Now, all I ever do is just take it and bend this tab up a little bit. Now we're going to get the intake off and it comes right back. And then there's a bracket up here for the fuel line that goes to the passenger side cylinder head. We'll just take the bolt loose on it, on the front of the intake here. Now this one's pretty short, so you might want to make sure that you keep it in place because it's different than the other ones. You can see it's a little bit shorter than the other ones here that we use. Just by comparison, this is the one that was at the front of the intake. This is the one, it's the same ones for the front of the oil line on the turbo, or the bracket here on the turbo pedestal. They're all the same size as far as what comes out of there. They're the same, so make sure you keep that one separate. Okay, we're going to remove the coupler hose for the EGR cooler, the oil cooler. I usually just put a little bit of WD-40 on there so it slides easier. Now what you can do, there's a notch on it. There's a notch on this. We don't want to go by the line so much because sometimes it shifts. As you can see right here, right there, there's a little bit of a notch in the metal stainless part that's a liner for it. So we're going to turn that straight up and down. And if you have to, take a pair of pliers and squeeze it. But you can either look at the notch being straight up and down, lined up with this, or there's flats on the side, which I'll show you in a second. And once you do that, that puts the retaining, there's like a piece inside there, spring steel that holds it. Once it's lined up like that, we should be able to move it right back. Now some of them stick. They don't come off this easy. This one's sliding off, but if they don't come off this easy, if they don't come off that easy, or you can't get it off, you can just pry it back. The same result. It doesn't hurt anything, as long as you don't break the nipple off, of course. But just push it back out of the way. Then we'll get the intake bolts off here. Okay, we're going to remove the intake bolts now, and you notice some of them have studs on them and some don't. All of them will have a stud on the back here because of the bracket. Well, not all of them have the bracket, but all of them have the ground wire on there, so all of them have that. But different years and vans will have them in different location, so you can either take it and mark it, get a Sharpie and mark them, or you can take a picture with your, pull out your cell phone or a camera and just take a picture of them where they are. Just do something with them. I also leave the bolts in it once I'm pulling it off, so I don't have an issue. But you can't sit there and copy this one because it may be different on yours by the year that it is. So let's go ahead and get the intake bolts off. Okay, on this back one, I just take my pry bar, stick it aside there, pull it aside, and get it out. Now we have all the bolts off. We have the fuel line loose. We're going to bend it forward a little bit. These are all loose. All the bolts are out. We should be able to lift the intake up. And again, we cleaned off, made sure that we don't have anything on there. Watch your fuel line here. Make sure you don't break anything. Lift it up and pull it out. Now one of the things also I'll suggest, because we have all these holes open, again, make sure we don't have anything up here that can fall down in it. We already blew it off and looked for anything that go in there. Now when you scrape these off, make sure that you don't get anything down inside the holes as we do it. And depending on where you climb it or what area that you're in, you may or may not have more dirt on here. So I'll go ahead and clean all these off. Take some brake cleaner or carb cleaner,
spray it. Just because I want the tape to adhere. I'm going to put tape over it. Just to keep the anything from falling in there. If not, if you want to use toilet paper, tissue, that's all up to you. Rags. If you use any of that stuff, you just got to be careful when you pull it out that you don't let stuff fall in there. So you got to be careful with it. Okay, now we're going to remove the oil cooler. And again, I can't stress enough that we can't get any contamination in here. That's why I have the drain back tube in here to keep from getting contamination, blowing it back into this hole. So we have the drain back tube in there, and we're going to clean all this off before we even think about lifting it off. And also we're going to separate the front cover. So we have a total of 530 Torx. So I'm going to take them, and what I'm doing here is I'm just taking my pick and I'm cleaning them off here. We've got a total again of 5 small 30 Torx and 5 of the 45 Torx. Same size that we used to get those off of 45 Torx. So I'm going to clean off the cavity here on each one so it's easier to get my tool in there. We have that, and then also I'm going to take a screwdriver and go along the edges of this, of the oil cooler base, and break anything loose before I blow it off. So we get this all loose. I get these probably one or two a week where people's worked on them and have contamination in here. And again, the record's 7 times I've had to clean this IPR screen up to a guy's, and that's why I always ask them, my truck died, did you do any recent work to it? Has anybody's done anything with the oil cooler or worked on this thing the last 2,000 miles? First thing we're going after is the IPR screen. Okay, so I have that done. Now we'll blow it off. Especially right here between the front cover and the oil cooler. Unbolt the oil cooler. Okay, I got my Torx 45. I have 4 in the back here. You don't have to separate these in the vehicle. I do. It doesn't make any difference whether you do it in or out of the vehicle. Same thing. So I have the 5 45s out. Now we go out to the 30s. Same thing, we have 5 of them. A total of 5. We have 3 in the top cover and 2 in the nipple. Back that. It's going to leak. I'll take rags. You want to get probably 3, 4, 5 rags back here to keep it from leaking out the valley and onto the ground here. I'll take that. Remove this. And again, it doesn't matter because when we take this oil cooler off, it's going to be all full inside there of oil, so it's going to come back. The only way I know to avoid that is if you do the coupler first. Because when you do the coupler in the back, all this oil would drain down. But if you're not doing the coupler, you have no choice but to do it this way. Okay, we're going to take off the oil cooler base, or the housing that holds actually the oil cooler on it. And pretty much the bolts are spaced about 2 inches apart, with the exception of the driver's side. There's not one up here. There's only 3 down the side on the driver's side. So we'll take off all the bolts here that
hold the oil cooler on. I've got all the bolts out. And again, it's going to drain quite a bit. So I just usually lift it up a little bit. Set it there for a second. Let the rags absorb what it's going to. So let that absorb for like maybe a minute or two. Okay, now that we have the cover loose, the rags soaked up for a second, let's take the oil cooler, put in something to minimize the mess as I lift it out over the vehicle so I don't damage the customer's vehicle, and get it out. Now we're going to clean that up. Okay, again, can't stress enough about cleansing this, keeping this area clean. I just take it, push everything away from the opening here. Also, as you're doing it, if you put it over here, don't pick the rags up and contaminate your area once you just tried to keep it clean. Watch what you're doing. Make sure you don't put anything back inside the holes up here, because you're just defeating your purpose. And then I just took an old Carl's Jr. cup, and I started to pull out my old oil, because we're going to clean the cavity out and replace the screen. Let's get this oil out. Okay, I have it just about clean. If you look in one of my previous videos where I show the Dorman one, you see this screen. Well, a couple things. One, it's common to see this screen torn. The new style's made out of better material, it doesn't tear. But the Dorman ones, you'll see these completely full of the old seals filling. That's why another reason why I say not to use a Dorman. So I'm gonna go ahead and clean this up better. Again, focusing on wiping away from the cavity. Make sure nothing goes down inside of there. And remember, your rag could be contaminated too, so don't be careful of which way you're wiping and where's the position of your rags at. So we'll go ahead and clean this up, get these out of here. Okay, I'm gonna take all the rags, focusing on not dumping anything, making sure nothing wants to fall inside there. Lift it up away from all my other areas. Now you see why we have stuff covering the intake. Focus on keeping that clean. Get my rags out of there. Now we'll clean that out a little bit better and do the oil cooler. Okay, we'll clean this up a little bit to put it in there. We've got to get this nipple off of here. So what I'll do is I'll get underneath there and pry, and also pry here on the back side to get it off. Just try to go up straight with it so it doesn't break. We have the nipple off. There's a gasket in here that you have to replace, so make sure you get this one. Want to do this seal in here. Now I'm going to take this, as you can see there's a lot of oil and coolant still in there, so I'll go ahead and let it drain for a minute. And if you rotate it in a couple times, you get more of it out. Okay, I've got the cover a little bit cleaned up here. There's four bolts that hold in the oil cooler off on this housing. They're all 13 millimeter from the factory, so let's go ahead and get them off. Now if you lose one of these bolts, it has to be the right size. You get one that's just a little bit longer,
they break through. These are where the bolts go through, here and here. If you use a long bolt, it goes all the way through and cracks this, and you end up with an oil leak. I'm telling you that from experience, so don't do that. Now we have the bolts out. Now you need something to support the housing while we take the cooler out. So I just use here, you can use 2x4s, whatever else you have. We got these two blocks. So we take it, support the housing on it. And I'm going to tap it out right here. And then on this one, because it's almost flush with the housing, we don't want to damage it, I just grab anything, extension, whatever it takes that stays on top, and I'll stick it on there. Now I have something to pound on, this one and this one. So I'll just tap on it here. Take it out there. There's not any damage to it. So now we'll get the other cooler. We're going to replace all these seals. There's also a seal on this. Unless you have the 03 or the 04 style, that's all made into it. But this one, if you have the metal one here, just tap it out and there's an O-ring. That's on the 04 and up, has this. So let's go ahead and replace the seals in this. Okay, now here's the cooler, the insert we're going to use. And here's all the seals that came in the box here, in the gasket, in the bag. Now you're going to use every seal in here, with the exception of, again, maybe this smallest one, and that's if you have the 03 style that had the type that's all made, that's cast into it. It'll have a raised piece like this, and you won't use that. But since we have an 04 and up style, we're going to use every seal. Now if you notice here, there's two different sizes of these, a small one and a big one. I take the big one, I work it on first. Again, being careful with your pick not to damage it or not to roll it, I'll put my seal on the bottom one first. Being careful with it. Same way here, just take it, don't puncture it, and put your seals on. Okay. We have our oil cooler right now ready. Okay, we'll take the old seals out of here. And sometimes they get to be pretty confusing, the old ones and the new ones. So once I take them out, I like to make sure I have them far away from, or at least away from what I'm doing here. So we'll take, I'm going to go ahead and clean these off and be right back. Okay, I've got the cavities cleaned out. You need to use some grease or some assembly lube. Just take a little bit in there because we want to make sure that we hold the seal in place. We don't want it to come out while we're going back together. Also, you want to make sure that the areas here where the oil cooler is going to slide in is well lubricated. So we get these lubricated. Stick our seals in, make sure they're in the right spot. It's more or less pushed down. Don't cause it to out of the cavity. And again, it's the larger one for here. This part is the larger O-ring. We'll take it. And usually what I like to do here is make sure they don't fall out. Because during assembly, I want to make sure they don't shift. Lubricate. And then on the one here, it's a smaller one. Lubricate a little bit. And it also has the hexagon shape, so line it up, match it up so it's all the way in, and push it in. So now we have that all lubricated. We'll take our oil cooler. Lubricate those. Inspect it one more time. Nothing's out of place. Take it, look at it. Push it together. There we go. Now we're going to torque the bolts down. Get it all started, tighten it up.
okay, we have it all done, have everything in place, and go ahead and assemble it. Well, okay, now we have to put the blue gasket on. It only fits properly one way. Now when you're working this on, just push it straight up and down. Don't sit there and work it in like this, just stretch the gasket. So just take it, I usually put it in my corners or all the areas that have on the corners here, and just take it, push it straight up and down inside. And once it's in there, especially while my hands are still slimy here from the assembly lube, I'll just take it and work it in. Make sure it's all seated all the way down. There we go. Now we have it ready, assembled to go onto the vehicle. So let's clean it up there, install our new screen. Again, it's a lot better screen. Okay, now we're going to take all these bolt holes and blow them out. Because whenever you have these blind holes or they get full of fluid like this, they could hydraulic, give you a false torque. So we're going to make sure that we get all the bolt holes blown out. So just take it, stick a rag over it. Again, being careful of contamination. We don't want it coming back into the cavity here. We'll blow them all out. Then we have all the bolt holes blown out. Look for a buildup here. We've got a little bit, so I'm going to clean this off before I set the cooler down. Okay, with the surface clean and the cavity not contaminated, we'll go ahead and set the screen on there. This actually, the oil cooler on top of here pushes down and retains it. Then we'll take the cooler and set it in there. And tighten it down and torque it down. Then we'll start on the top. Pretty much for the same thing for the cover here. We'll just remove the old seals. We're going to clean it up once we remove the seals. Then we're going to put some assembly lube and get them inside of there. Won't bore you with all the details. I'll go ahead and clean this up and start to assemble it. I'll take it here, put some anything, grease, assembly lube, whatever you have, just to retain the seals so we don't lose it during assembly. We'll put it on all the different areas throughout it. Put the seal in. Same thing, set it in place and just tap it down. Don't try to push it in, you just stretch it. This one gets a little funny right here, so you want to be careful as you set it down that it doesn't fall out. Okay, looking good. Let's go ahead and put this on. Okay, we have it. Gasket's in place. Again, make sure it's not falling out. Don't want to do this twice. Set it on there. And just remember, again, you have five of the Torx 45s. And on this cover, you have three of the Torx 30, then you have the two for the nipple. You do have a total of five of each. So you have the four back here, and the one up front here. Now the same thing, just like anything else, draw it down evenly. These Makitas or Milwaukees are dual speed. You can sit and go slow or fast, pretty nice. But we'll just draw it down, just start, as soon as it starts coming down. Just draw it all down. Then we can go ahead and snug this up now that we've got it where we want it. I'm gonna do the 30s. Put the nipple on. Okay, we're down to the nipple here. I've got it lubricated here, lubricated around the upper ring. We'll go ahead and try to push it down. Got the new seal in there, same way with the grease to hold it in. And we're just snug up these 30s and get it on.
Okay, now when I'm doing the intake, again, I leave the bolts and everything in here to hold it up. But if you're not sure on your gasket, what you may want to do is check them first. Let me show you a couple things. One, check and make sure that the rubber is still pliable and the rubber is above the plastic. That is cleaned off. Make sure your gasket's clean. Now, the couple tricks that I can tell you with them. We don't have problems with these intakes. It is Ford's policy to reuse these gaskets, so I'm not telling you something here that's not proven out there. Just make sure that none of the seals are torn and that it's not hard, that it's still pliable. But if you see here, this lip that goes up into the intake, I'll see guys that'll take them and have them backwards and have them into the head, or have them like this into the head, and then if you do that, they don't sit properly, or you might end up with a pressure leak under boost. So anyhow, this goes into the intake, into the grooves. We'll put it on here. Now stick it so the bolts are partially through. And that holds it. And the same way with the other side. Make sure it's clean, make sure it's good. We'll do that. Let's go ahead and do the EGR cooler. And if you notice, you have the back one here with a stud. Some of the old 03s have studs on both. Usually it's just here on the back, and that's just for the wiring loom to hold it on. Go ahead and loosen them up. Take the cooler off. Okay, we have the bolts going through. We have our new gasket. I put it on there. We have the hole lubricated here for the seal, and also lubrication on the seal itself. So we'll take it. I just set it up to it. I like doing it this way because then we can watch and make sure that the gasket stayed on in place. Once we get the bolt started and we know our gasket's in the right spot, we can push it up in there and snug them up the rest of the way. Now we don't tighten it up yet because we need that to line it up with the up pipe on it. So we just bring the bolts down and snug them up by hand and go ahead and assemble it. Do that the same way back here with this bolt. Okay, we have the EGR cooler all snugged up on there. And if you notice, we leave the bolts just a little bit loose. We just finger tighten them all. So it's seated, we've got them all started, and it's good. And that's just because back here, it's actually quite a bit when you're trying to align it. So we'll leave that the way it is. And again, I can't stress enough that we use a genuine hose here, the Dorman ones. I see them leak. They either leak around the liners here, or they leak in other places. So we want to make sure that we use a genuine one here. You don't want to do it twice. And this is what I was talking about earlier as far as a notch. This notch goes up at 12 o'clock to take it off. Or you can also see these flats here on the side. They go like at, say, 3 o'clock and 6 o'clock, or 3 o'clock and 9 o'clock, like that. But mostly the notch goes up.
and this goes into the nipple. The backside with nothing goes down the EGR cooler. So we'll take that, slide it on, and we'll get ready to reassemble it now, to assemble it on the car. Let's go ahead and put it on the truck.
Yeah, I've got a little bit of grease to hold this on. You can use grease, silicone, whatever you want, just something just to hold it in place while we assemble it. Again, be careful here. Make sure there's no contamination. You want to make sure that your bolt holes are clear. If they aren't, blow them out, because if not, you're going to get a false torque on your intake. So let's make sure that all your bolt holes look good. These all look pretty good. So now I have the cooler on here. Make sure that you have the O-ring up front in the front cover. And let's set it down in here. And usually I lay down so I can put my chest against the body and have some leverage. Get your fuel line out. Make sure all your wires out of the way like that, your glow plug wiring. And right now I'm going to focus mostly on getting that. So we'll go ahead and line it up here. Okay, I went and jacked up the exhaust a little bit to get myself clearance because I was fighting it to go on there. So I got a floor jack holding the exhaust up. Now again, with everything in here, we can take it, focus on right there, and get it, and it all lines up. So now it's all seated, and get some of the bolts started. Helps a lot more with this exhaust out of the way. Normally with factory exhaust, it doesn't fight me. But this one is. Okay, so now with all the bolts started, make sure they all start, especially your end ones. We're gonna draw it down. But now it's also, you get the most clearance before it gets clamped down. Let's go ahead and put this on. That way you also keep it aligned. So let's feed this through. Again, back up over that bolt. And just reach back here, squeeze it together, and hook it. Now once that's hooked like that, it's not coming out. So we have that done, and let's start snugging these bolts up. Same thing, we're going to draw them down even. Make sure we don't have anything in here, none of the glow plug wiring, nothing else in here, fuel line, everything's freed up. So let's go ahead and snug it up. We got everything, and make sure that you do have your hose on here. You can even pull it up now if you want to. And just anywhere other than that notch being straight up and down. So there we go. Let's tighten it up. Same thing, like always, just draw it down even. Now normally when I do this, I'll draw it all down, make sure all the bolts are good, everything's right, and I'll go over it three times just to make sure that I have it seated properly once I get them all done. So I'm going to go ahead and torque these. And this is what I meant by the jack to help hold the exhaust up. Normally on the stock trucks, you don't have to do this on the stock exhaust, but on the aftermarket ones, you do. Even though this one's stock, it must have been loose or something's going on to make it not line up. Usually I got enough clearance to get the intake on without an issue. But yeah, now that I've got the intake torqued down, I'm going to go ahead and take this out. Otherwise, it's harder to get the turbo on.
Okay, now with the intake all on, we're going to go ahead and tighten up the EGR cooler. Remember, we left it a little bit loose for the final adjustments. So we snug it up here. Make sure it's all good. Get that, then draw the clamp up back here. Position it. Usually you want it just straight up and down. Thank you. There we go. Now we have that. We're just going to go ahead and assemble the turbo and get that on and keep going. Okay, the only thing I just did real quick off camera, I put the turbo pedestal back on, just bolted it up, and I put that other large O-ring that was in the package here at the base of the, at the top of the oil cooler, at the base of this oil filter housing. Again, we wanted on this thing, I have no issues ever reusing all these seals. You just want to make sure that they're in there. And then also you want to make sure that as you do this, that you, this is real critical, because we'll see these broke. And they're expensive, you're looking at a couple $100. Make sure that as you do this, you draw it down evenly. Don't damage anything. Have this with the washer stacked on it, just take it off, make sure it's clean, make sure you don't have any dirt on it. I usually just stick it through there, put my washer on the back side, and get it started straight. And the same way with all these. Hopefully they all lined up, nothing should have gotten bent. And just get them all on there. And start to snug them up. Okay, now once we got these all four tightened, all four of your fuel lines, remember the shorter bolt, we put it back in up here. Snug it up. Then we're going to bring the wire loom over. So now, the only thing I can say that's important is make sure that your glow plug one is down first, because it fits underneath your wire loom, and just bring your wire loom up and over. Now some of them, like your 04, you'll have some of them that go up here. So 03, 04 may be different, where the wire loom's in front, some are going back, so you can't copy this one. And some of them, your EBP, your exhaust back pressure sensors up front here. So it's going to be a little bit different depending on the year. But pretty much we just do that. All of them, this does go underneath the fuel line here. So feed you two lines through there. Put it back in place right here. Make sure all these clip. They all go on. Work this around your line, like the same way, the opposite of the way we took it off there. Make sure that your glow plugs go all the way seated and snap. And go ahead and push them on. That's all looking good. Get this down here. Get your oil temp sensor and your oil pressure switch plugged in. This out of the way for the now the other thing I can say, your valve cover bolt, make sure it's a regular bolt, not a stud. If you have a stud there, sometimes it'll rub through on your wire loom, so make sure that's okay.
And the same way now with this glow plug one, make sure that goes underneath there. That goes on the front stud there. Depending again on the year, if you have 03, 04, it stays down there. So everything's different on this one. And some of these has the thing that clips on and some don't. So we have that there. Go ahead and tighten that up. Once you put those in and just push it over, it latches it. Same way over here. We have that. Now we're about ready for the injector wire loom. Okay, we have most of the wire loom on besides the IPR, which we'll do in a second. So we'll go ahead and take the injector wire loom and feed it through here. We just set it down here. If the clips didn't break, there's a clip right there in front of the oil cooler. We just push that on. A lot of those break off just because the heat of the turbo. No big deal. I see more of them missing. Now we just feed the injector underneath it, underneath the main wire loom, and we make sure that all these go on. They should go more or less 12 o'clock straight up on all these, and make sure they all click, and don't try to manhandle it. You push the injector connector back in, then you have to pull your valve cover off. So let's go ahead and do them all. If they don't go on, find out why. It could be the O-ring out of place, or it could be that there's a piece of dirt in there. Just blow it out and fix it. And also, again, those studs, that's what they're for there, the wire loom, so we work that out. This is for the alternator. That stud that's up here again, we just set that on there. I just put this back out of the way for right now. Then back here on this side, same thing. Remember that fed through those last two? This is going to go on the bracket when I go back on. Now, this, I usually put this, pull this back, stick it on the IPR, feed it up in there, and then pull the lever up over and clasp it. Make sure it's on. Then when I do that, I can pull that off and redo it. Now we're good there. The same way, just make sure all the injectors are connected. This does go underneath here. Both of them, both of the injector wire looms go underneath the main wire loom up front. Okay, we'll put the ground wire on back there with the bracket. Put the EBP on there. Get the bracket on. Some brackets have two bolts back here, some just have this one. Some have no bracket. So if you don't have this bracket, don't worry about it. Just put your ground on the back stud. Snug this all up and get the turbo on. Okay, we put the tab back on. Get it back in shape. Then we'll put the turbo on. I'm gonna put the turbo back on. If you notice, I have the clamp in place back here. Well, not in place, I just have it stuck on the turbo in front of the ring. So we put it down here. We feed it the same way, the opposite of what came out. We start off sideways, I guess. I'm going to rotate it. Now as I'm doing this, I'm going to bring it down. I'm trying to assemble it onto the exhaust a little bit or get it out of the way. Well, here, actually, let me show you on this angle. Okay, what I'm trying to do, I'm trying to line the downpipe up, the drain back tube, I'm sorry. I'm going to try to line the drain back tube up while I'm also fighting this downpipe right here. So I'm going to put my hand in here, move that out of the way with my hand. As I bring the turbo over,
Now I'm about above it. I'm going to rotate the turbo a little bit and start trying to line it up. And see, once it's all lined up, I just kind of lift it up, let it drop into place. Now it's all into place there. All that's good. Then we just have to line up the pipe over here. Okay, so let me show you what I do over here on this side to line it up.
Okay, now what we want to do is verify that the dowel's lined up, like right here, that the dowel's in the right spot on what we can see. So we know the turbo's seated. Now what we have to do is line up the exhaust right here. So we're going to take it and get that exhaust together, otherwise we're going to have a big exhaust leak. And judging by the ficums that I get back, there's quite a few out there that have exhaust leaks. So we're going to close that up.
Okay, now with this one being an 05 and up, it already has this bracket that we've been working with the whole time. If you have an 03 and 04, it may not have it on there. And if you look up my exhaust leak video, I show doing this thing and how to do it. But since this one has it, it's actually real easy. If you take that same 24-inch pry bar I've been using the whole time and just pry against that and seat it together. Now, as you can see, it's all seated. It makes it real easy. And I just reach up, take my clamp, open it up and put it over it, and close it up. Now I can rotate it and do it. Now I just get the bolts in and get it all started. Okay, I'm just trying to show some of the highlights where people's asked me on doing the job where they have issues with. So we're gonna go back with installing the ficum. I have all of them down here. I'll set the ficum pretty much in place, and I'll feel, starting with the one that's closest to the body, I'll get it started. And I reach up inside here and rock it back and forth and click it up in there. And then the same way with the next one. I know this isn't really easy to see, but same thing. I'm going to get it, feel it going up and starting in the slot. Once it feel it start in there, just grab it until it clicks. And the same way up here. Get it started. And then go till it clicks. Now I have all the ficum connected. So hopefully that helps out with it. And another highlight thing I can show real quick on this.
Now again, I'm doing this hose here. This is only on the 05 and up style. Well, some of the 04s, the recall may have this plastic one. The 03, 04 with the rubber ones we don't worry about. And if you're doing this in a colder climate, colder month, you might want to take a blow dryer and heat it up. Just heat your ends up or stick it out in the sun. It helps out a lot. I put the end on the charge air cooler first. I'll get down here, put it on, and then rock it back and forth. Put it on until it seats against there. And now up here on this one, I'll get it started. I'll put my 24-inch pry bar in here. And I start to push here while I'm pushing with this. Same thing, rock it. Pop it on that way. Put it through here, push it, pop it on there. Now I have that on. Let me snug this up. Not sure on the radiator shroud, and that's pretty much almost going to cover it. Okay, one thing on the cold side here, you've got to make sure that your clamp is way out of the way. There is a place here to line it up, but sometimes you're going to be out of position. So make sure your clamp is way over here, because if the bolt's anywhere pointed straight up and down or this way, the snorkel won't go through and it'll bind up. So just make sure that your bolt's coming up out of this way on it when you go to snug it up. That way you don't have an issue with the air filter. Okay, now in doing the shroud, we took the brackets back off. Put it back in. We're going to move this back here for a second. We're going to feed the shroud down. Again, paying attention, being careful not to break our fan wires. Feed it down as much as you can, which is usually about here. I just want to get something to protect this nipple and get started there. Now from the underside, I'm going to go pry it out and push it down. If you have help, that helps either, helps too, but if you don't, you can do this by yourself. I'll show you here. Okay, our goal is to get these tabs into the area here for him. So I'm going to take it, pull out on it, bring it down a little bit, And now what I mostly want to just do is get it enough so it's underneath it. There we go. Now I have it here and back here on the radiator. I can either try to grab the lip here and pull down on it. We can do it that way. Or since it's here for right now, we'll go back on the top and tap it in.
We have the last little bit. It's down. We know we have it there. So I just take it and tap it. And now it's in place. We'll put the cable back. Again, as we go back together, make sure the clamp's back on the same area that it came off. And snug it up. We have that on. Okay, then once you've got the alternator stuff back on, you got the belts all lined up on the pulleys, just put it back on there. Verify that they're on everywhere, including the power steering. All you have to do is just grab it and listen. Now you have it. Belts on, everything's good. Okay, now as you torque these down, pretty much we're just going to go until we have the spring compressed and just snug it up. It doesn't get real tight. If you over tighten them, you're either going to break the clamp or have issues. If you pull it on off on this end and you over tighten it, you're going to taper the tube and ruin it. So we'll just draw it down. Watch the spring get compressed. Now we can just go and we just snug it up here. I'm just going until I actually feel some real resistance. I'm not going tight. There we go, I got some real resistance in there. Same way on both sides down here too. Okay, now on these, almost always these O-rings are stretched out like that. I've got another video showing how to buy these O-rings if you want to buy them by bulk. If not, just you can go down to Ford, but they're stupid. They're like anywhere from $5 to $7 for an O-ring. I get the part number there and get them online. Buy them by the dozen or even more than that. We'll just put that back on. I'll thread it in at the same time I put it there. And I put it on the turbo and go buy the wire loom here all at the same time. And set it all down in place. Get that to pop in, and now we can snug it up. There's a line there that we line up. Snug this up and put it in the coolant bottle. Now with this here, the clips usually don't want to go back in, so I just use the door panel clips here and tap them on. Help to hold your wire loom back up. Now we can do the degas bottle. Okay, we'll put the air filter on, just feed it down through here. Make sure the cooling lines are on there. Now, if it gives you any problems, just reach in and pull it up while it goes down. Take your hose off back here. Put it down while you string this hose up. And put it all on. Make sure it's seated down there. Hose on up there. This goes underneath here. Let me start hooking the battery up in a second. If you have the 05 and up style, this goes above it. 03, 04 goes underneath it. We'll put that on. Put that back on. Put this back in. Hook our hose up, tighten that up. Okay, you ready to about start this thing. Okay, one of the things I do to prime this wire right here goes from the body right down to your starter. It's just a single yellow wire. So we're going to take it, squeeze the sides. I'm going to pull it out. Now as you see, I have this end here, this bullet connector, and I'm going to crank the engine over. And one of the things you should do is keep out of the way, of course, of your belt and everything else at first, and let's bump the engine over. One of the things
They tell you not to crank these engines for over 30 seconds without giving it a few minutes rest. Well, a few things. One, that skipping, that's normal. I usually end up hearing that after we work on them. And also, as I'm cranking, listen, you hear a kunk-kunk-kunk-kunk-kunk-kunk inside. And that's because it doesn't have oil pressure. So when that goes away, then we're starting to build up oil pressure. So I'm going to crank it here again for another few seconds. And then listen to see if you hear that kunk-kunk-kunk-kunk-kunk as we go. It's better if you go in and crank it like this for it to build the prime up quicker. So I'm gonna let it rest and do that another two or three times to get this thing started and primed. Okay, we're about ready to get base oil pressure. You can actually hear the difference. So let's see what this is. Hear the difference in the tone. Most of the questions. Again, I got the website up now. It's dieseltechron.com, and people's asking me different questions. So now I'm trying to cover it because I get questions on the wiring loom or torquing this or doing that, how to get the exhaust to line up. So I thought I'd follow one through, do it, showing definitely all the highlights, everything I did. So if that helps you, please like and subscribe, and answers all the questions that I've been getting lately, and covers all the doing the oil cooler on the Ford, and also doing a bulletproof EGR cooler. Thank you.